Thank you, Diane. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, in unison, that's wonderful.
Huh?
I didn't train them. They know what their job is. Announcements. We have announcements up there. And if anybody has an announcement, we've got a microphone. Oh.
We've got a microphone and a baby going around.
Yeah, wow. Yeah.
Steve.
I'll be putting the orders in for the chicken dinner next Sunday, on Tuesday, to the American Legion. So if you are planning on doing the chicken dinner, please let me know today and have the money.
Oh.
They don't take credit cards.
This is the church's week at the food pantry, and we have been very busy, so I hope that everybody can give a couple hours if you can. Monday 1 to 3, and Wednesday and Friday 10 to noon. Thanks.
I just want to make sure everybody came in should have got a little stone, right? Everybody got stoned when they came in, right? Okay. Good. A little stone. Stone. A little stone.
Not a rock, a stone.
I just want to remind everyone that we are hosting, or Claude and I are hosting, a wedding reception for our son Connor, who grew up in this church. Invitations are on the table in Fellowship Hall. We just wanted to extend a welcome to everybody, and we'll have some good food and hopefully lots of fun conversation, and hopefully you'll join us May 27th, and details are on the invitation. Thank you.
Diane.
Speaking of weddings, we have an anniversary tomorrow, 52 years for Don and Lynn Bateson.
The applause is really for Lynn putting up with Don.
Hello. Good morning. Following on the path of the food pantry, our community dinner is this coming Friday, and we would always welcome some volunteers. Mike and I are going to be serving, but we need as much help as we can, and we do need cookies. We have enough for 92 people out there right now. I just counted this morning, but we've been getting 130 people lately, so a lot of need. So anybody who can help, it's from 5 to 6 on Friday. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Betsy. Any other messages, announcements? There are notepads or attendance books in your aisles. Please sign those, date them, because we probably don't collect them every day. Would be good. And if there are no more announcements, then let's, for those who are able, please stand for the call to worship. We are God's household, crafted by the architect of creation.
Our hearts are sheltered for the outcast, our hands open to the stranger.
We are God's people, created in divine image.
To tell others of God's love, to offer mercy as freely as you have received.
We are God's children, called to give of ourselves.
Chosen to serve the lost and lonely, gifted to minister to a hurting world.
Let us pray together. Most gracious God, as we continue to celebrate the resurrection of Christ, we pray that we may be bound together in Christian love, and that our faith and fellowship may be a witness through which your Spirit will bring others into your church. We humbly thank you for your many blessings you have given us. We ask that we may learn how to be truly Easter people, and always remember that we are celebrating resurrection every day. For we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And at this time, we'd ask you that you share the peace from a distance, or if you choose, or not.
Yeah, you want to go hug somebody, go hug somebody.
This is the part of our service that used to be like herding cats. It would take 15 minutes to get everybody to sit back, get back to their position. Anyway, our hymn of praise is Christ is Made for Sure Foundation, which is 275 in the Chalice Hymnal or on the walls.
Would know that song better if I would not have picked the wrong tune. If we sang it to the other tune, it would make sense to you. But thank you for trying, Diane, and putting up with my inability to pick the right tune. Yes, so you please, all sounded great.
Please be seated. Yes. Now, Gene, you do know you've armed us with stones.
Hey now, we'll get to that later. We'll cover that in a little bit, yes.
Gene and I were talking about who was whose straight man, and I don't know. I don't know. We're not sure. The epistle reading for today is from Acts 7:55 through 60. It's a story you're familiar with, I know, the story of Stephen. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed steadily into the heavens and saw the glory of God. And he saw Jesus standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. And he told them, "Look, I see the heavens open, and the Son of Man is standing in the place of honor at God's right hand." And they put their hands over their ears and began shouting. They rushed at him and dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. His accusers took off their coats and laid him at the feet of a young man named Saul. As they stoned him, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And he fell to his knees and shouted, "Lord, don't charge them with this sin." And with that, he died. May the Lord add his blessing to these words.
Thanks, Mike. From John chapter 14. "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and also trust in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am. And you know the way to where I am going. No, we don't, Lord, Thomas said. We have no idea where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. If you had really known me, you would have known who my Father is. From now on, you do know him, and you have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus replied, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and yet you still don't know who I am? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. So why are you asking me to show him to you? Don't you believe that I am the Father, and the Father is in me? The words I speak are not my own, but my Father who lives in me does his work through me. Just believe that I am the Father. I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Or at least believe because of the work you have seen me do. I tell you the truth. Anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works, because I am going to be with the Father. You can ask for anything in my name, and I will do it, so that the Son can bring glory to the Father. Yes, ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. All right, all of you, as Mike pointed out, have been given a stone this morning. Anybody not get a stone? If you don't have one, make sure you get one. Keep it in your hand. Don't throw it. At the end of the sermon, if you feel like throwing it, Mike, you go right ahead.
Should I take my coat off now?
Yes, yes, yes. As you hold that stone in your hand, be aware of its color and its shape. Does it have any distinguishing features about it? Does it have anything that stands out? Is it large or small? Is it rough or smooth? You can give it a name if you like. How long ago were pet rocks a thing? 70s maybe? Right? So if you want to give it a name, give it a name. Yep. It doesn't take long to get to know your stone. And I bet by the end of worship, if I were to gather them up again and ask you to find yours, could you find it?
Yeah. Probably, yeah, right?
You would say, that one is mine, right? And if somebody else took yours, you might take objection to that, because that was my stone, right? Yeah. It's interesting how easy we slip into the language of mine and yours. Who do these stones belong to? There's a whole plate full of them. I don't know how many are left back there, Elizabeth. You were handing them out. Thank you very much. Probably a lot, right? Yeah. Who do they belong to? Is that one now yours because it was given to you? Or they belong to me because I brought them to worship this morning? You've gotten to know your stone. You don't want to give it up. Would you give yours up, Mike?
Not easily.
Right, yeah, right. Because it's now yours, right? Yeah, it's yours. If I try to take it back, you might not want me to take it back. It may seem kind of silly to even wonder about, you know, whose stone they might be, but most of the world's wars and conflicts around the globe nowadays are fought over nothing more than the ownership of who the stones belong to, right? Whose land is whose? Something as simple as rocks, earth, and sand bring out all the possessiveness in all of us. And if you don't believe that, just let somebody step on your property, Mike, and what happens? What are they doing in my yard? Get off my yard! Raises your blood pressure a little bit. Why are they standing in my spot? Why are they in my space? Even at the office, somebody sits in my chair, it's like, hey, that's my chair, right? Yeah, don't sit in my chair. It's my chair. And this was at the heart, I think, of the problem that Stephen faced. It was stones that killed him in more ways than one. The reason why he was condemned to death was that he was accused of blasphemy, right? He was guilty of saying something that offended the most deeply held convictions of the people at the time. It wasn't his allegiance to Christ that got him into trouble. It was his attitude to the temple, that building made of stones. Right? His accusers said, "This man never stopped saying things against the holy place and the law. For we have heard him say," we've heard him say many times, we've heard him say, "that Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and will change the customs that Moses handed down to us." Stephen's defense, though, was just before this passage that Mike read. We have, it was a long speech arguing that they did not need the temple, that building made of stone and rock. "The Most High," Stephen says, "does not live in the house made by hands." Now, that may not seem too objectionable to us nowadays, but back then, Stephen says the Most High does not live there where you think he lives, where you go to visit him. He's not there. And that's what got him killed. He said that the stones of the temple, the heart and focus of the people of Israel, would be thrown down. And what's more, he said that it didn't matter. It doesn't matter if it gets tossed aside or thrown down or destroyed. So to understand why the people got so fired up against him, let's go back a little bit and understand the history of the temple somewhat. So in their early history, the people did not have a temple, as we know. When Moses led them out of Egypt into the wilderness, the only thing that was set in stone were what? The Ten Commandments. They were housed in a box, the Ark of the Covenant, and it was placed in a tent, the tabernacle. It was quite elaborate, but it was definitely a tent, so they could roll it up and travel and move it whenever they had to move it. You could, you know, carry it from place to place. It reminded them that God was in their midst, encamped among them, but it was not a fixed place. It was movable. They didn't have a fifth wheel, so they had to carry it along where they went. But same kind of, you know, theory about that, right? Whenever they wanted to get up and go, they just rolled everything up, packed everything up, and left. But when they arrived at the Promised Land, when they got into the Promised Land, and they settled down, and these nomads became farmers and city dwellers, a little more stable and secure and kind of, you know, permanent, they built houses of stone. And after a while, it occurred to them, well, if we're here and settled, and we've got these houses that we built of stone, then maybe God should have one too. And it was King David who first suggested a temple should be built. And we have that account in the second book of Samuel. "See now," says David, "I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." But God comes back to David with his opinion. I have not lived in a house since the day I brought you people, the people out of Israel from Egypt. Did I ever speak a word saying, why have you not built me a house? God wasn't really bothered by it. In fact, God doesn't seem to even want David to build him a temple. But the people eventually went and built one anyway. For them, it was a sign that they were firmly established in the land and they were going to be there to stay. Once you start putting down one stone after another, it is plain that you have no intention of leaving, right? You are there for the long haul. You are there to stay. And the temple was a way of saying, this is our land. See, here is the house of our God firmly established, here to stay in the middle of everything we do. These stone walls of the temple prove that the stones of this land belong to who? Belong to us. Because our temple is here and we worship there, and that's where our God is. So the temple that Stephen spoke against was not that temple. The temple Stephen talked about was virtually new, and the business of temple building was a recent memory. It was very grand and impressive. It was a present statement of the